Hello, everyone. We're a little bit late. I promise you there's a lot of love in the room. And we've got some of our musicians back, and that's such a tonic just to be together. I wish you were in this room as well. So let's just settle ourselves for a minute. Remember, we're on holy ground. Let me remind you that your lounge room is also holy ground. We acknowledge today the land in which we are meeting, the traditional owners of this land, the Gadigal people and the Bidjigal, and we pay our respects to these people, past and present and emerging leaders also. It's very heartening to be able to say there are emerging leaders. G'day Peter, how you doing? Lovely to see you. Hey Joe. Hey Caroline. Hey Jennifer. As much as we can, we're bringing you right into this room because this is a beautiful space. Let's begin by saying the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We're going to do some songs, and sometimes people question me a bit about the songs we sing. One of the songs we're going to sing has become a Wayside absolute favourite, which is what we'll do first, which is Your Love Feeds My Soul. This thing just rocks and we love it. Lately I've been getting us to sing Tears in Heaven. Now, clearly this is not a religious song in one sense. In another sense it really is. The reason we sing it is that we live in a society that is very death denying. We don't see death, and when our old people get old, we shut them away somewhere. And some generations ago, when one of the old people died, we'd have them in the lounge room for a few days. And we're familiar with death. Now we are not. And so there are consequences for living in a death-denying society. I think, unless you are familiar with death, you are inclined to make little things loom large and allow large things to pass you by. So one of the few ways that cut through in this culture that we are in is that song Tears in Heaven, because people identify with Eric Clapton and the loss of his son. So we sing that song for that reason. And the other one we're doing is Bridge Over Troubled Waters. Now, that's one of the songs. There are many that were not meant to be sung in church, but my goodness me, when you sing them in church, and you can hear God singing this song to you. My God, the power in some of these songs. And Bridge Over Troubled Waters is one like that. It's a song that we could sing to each other equally. Another cracker of a song is one we did earlier this year that Claudia brought to us, which was...
He Needed Me.
By Anne Somebody. And we'll resurrect that song sometime soon. You Needed Me. If you slowly go through the words of that, it is the most appropriate love song between Jesus and us. So let's do the music. We'll start with the loud, rowdy one, because that's fun. We'll go from that one to Bridge Over Troubled Waters, and then we'll do Tears in Heaven. And Kylie will be here, and I'll be back there having fun with the musician.
Thank you. Oh. In heaven.
behind the scenes here, Adam is playing the guitar, and so Sam and me. And have you ever seen two guys glued to Adam's hand? I'm very pleased to be following Adam's lovely lead. For a prayer, I'd like to us take our way through the 23rd Psalm, slow cooking style. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. And in that one phrase, we just subverted our whole economy. We pray that you would be so present to us that we would find our centre is not located in here, but out there. As we discover the joys of servanthood and find the release in knowing the measure of enough and have the power to say, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Sometimes he leads me into lockdown. And it takes a while for me to look around and realize that the pastures are green. We can just, most of us, walk to the fridge and eat. That's not true for so many. When helicopters buzz overhead, they're not dropping bombs. The pastures are pretty green. He leads me beside quiet waters, usually the last thing we want is to be quiet. We fill our heads with commentary and it never ceases. If we're alone, we have earbuds. And he leads us to quiet waters. And he restores my soul. Oh my God. The promise of restoration of soul rings such a deep need in us that we just stop and say, restore to us ourselves again. For we frequently live absent to ourselves. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his namesake. Your name, of course, is your character. And when I recognize your character, my path appears to be straight. When my path is crooked, and all I think about is how the world affects me, I've lost the path. Help me to recognize your name, to see your character, to see your character in those about me, to see your character in the ocean just down the road, to see your character in the sunshine and the breeze that kisses me on the face. To see your character. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Nowhere do you promise a smooth ride. Indeed, we have trouble discriminating between what we would like, what we find entertaining, and what would be for the good. We mix completely how we feel and what should be. We even interpret your position by how we feel, as if you move away. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are with me. In the deepest, darkest hole, you are with me. In fact, especially in the deepest, darkest hole, you are with me. When things are travelling smoothly, I have no need of you, because I'm okay, thanks. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Those things are old instruments that are used for correction. Not normally comfortable about being corrected. But oh my God, what a relief. What a relief when some brother or sister catches me out where I'm the center of the universe and remind me about the freedom that comes from having my center located in you. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Just cop that for a second. If the whole world condemns us, if we make it to the front page of the paper as being the nastiest person in this society, you set before us a table, a banquet given in our honour. Ponder that. The number of times I've been busily beating myself up when you have set before me a banqueting table, a dinner given in my honour, and I'm flat out beating myself up. You anoint my head with oil. In other words, you call me to a high task. We anoint kings and queens with oil when we call them to be kings and queens, to be rulers. And you anoint my head with oil. In other words, you say, I have a destiny. I'm on a journey. I have not arrived. And tomorrow I won't have arrived, and the next day I won't have arrived, but I will be on my way. I don't have a dream so much as a destiny. A dream is located in me. My destiny requires my feet to move. My cup overflows. Man alive, does my cup overflow? Think of the love of my family, my daughter, my son-in-law, my wife. My cup overflows. I think of the friendships I have where pure gold is delivered into my presence and my cup overflows. And when I'm at my lowest, and when I'm out of resources and I haven't got a smart word in my mouth, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and unfailing kindness will follow me all the days of this little life, and then forever I will dwell in your presence. Amen. So, we have a reading, and then we have Janet. This is the Graham and Janet show. Now, we're broadcasting at least next week. I've been waiting for John. John's still away. John won't be here next week. I think I'll make an executive decision and say we are broadcasting for some time. I'll confirm that by email, but COVID is really out of control, and we just have to look after each other's health, and so for that reason my guess is through February probably. I'll keep you informed, but I think that's the way to go. So we're broadcasting for the near future. So we have a reader, then we have Janet. Thank you, Andrew.
Morning, everyone. This is the revised Graham version of Psalm 29. We create holiness by seeing it. We create holiness by naming it. In all that is beautiful, see the beautiful character of God. Fall in worship in the splendour of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is like a clap of thunder when you're at sea and have no protection. The voice of God can whisper and yell. It is powerful and majestic. The voice of the Lord is like the tsunami that swept away cities in Japan. The voice of the Lord is like a little goat that leaps around in the joy of being alive. The voice of the Lord shakes the ground to remind us that clever in our own eyes, we are just little things. Whether whispering like a breeze or thundering like a hurricane, those who recognize his voice fall to their knees and cry, "Glory!" The Lord is that which is beyond all we can say or think. When our language runs out, our prayer begins. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace.
Let me just say that was the Graham Revised Version. The original Hebrew doesn't say the Lord's like a tsunami that swept Japan away, but a little bit of poetic license.
Good morning. The Graham and Janet show. I kind of feel like maybe I should have gone before Graham on that breakdown of Psalm 23. Because this is the student, that's the teacher. I feel like we've riffed off each other a bit, have we, Graham?
Yeah.
We had a chat on Friday, which I'll talk about, but very much the student here. And probably a deep relief, like having me talk, because when I lead, I tend to come in the room and go, right, what's the song order, guys? Tim, have you got this? And everyone else is like, okay, just do the talk, Janet. It'd be much nicer, a lot quieter. I'm going to include the reading, the next reading, into my talk, and Kylie's going to help me when I point to her to read it in two parts. So yes, glory be to God that I get a chance to think about things. Glory be to Graham that I get a chance to think about things. And we both prepared chats, I'll listen it, you know, in case one of us becomes positive. I did a test and made sure that I was safe to come in. So last week and today, but last week I want to refer to Graham again. He beautifully riffed off the opening of, riffed off the opening of the Gospel of John. In the beginning, he talked about a philosopher called Heraclitus, yes, and about the moments in life that are always approaching and departure. We're always approaching and departing, which seems very spot on today and a good segue, because we're about to move to the Gospel of Luke. And this is a simultaneous departure approach in this passage. If you've got your Bibles out or you are that kind of person, we're going Luke 3, 15 to 22 in total. So yes, this is the year of Luke in a church calendar. I think they rotate the Gospels, basically. Wayside holds to that as much as Wayside feels like it, and that doesn't sound disrespectful at all. No, what I mean by that is sometimes there are things to talk about in the Bible, and we are given lots of choices every week. But this is the year of the Gospel of Luke. So I thought I'd give you a quick bio. Luke is talked about in the letters of Paul. He's described as a lovely, good doctor. He was with Paul in Rome. And in fact, Paul talks about a thorn in his side and that Luke is helping him. So maybe Luke was treating him, I don't know. He is an educated, highly literate Gentile pagan convert to Christ. He wrote the Gospel and the Book of Acts as a two-parter. In his correspondence, dear Theophilus, who may be a patron but is definitely a, well, hopefully a fellow convert, he's at pains to tell us and Theophilus that he has made a thorough investigation into Jesus's life, presumably using the Gospel of Mark as a bit of a template. Luke quotes Jewish literature extensively, most likely the Greek translation of the Torah, which is also called the Septuagint. He does this to drive home to his audience the authoritative basis for Jesus as the Messiah. Luke is actually the most inclusive of the Gospels. John is metaphysical and philosophical. Mark just goes to the end. But in Luke, we hear about and Mary and we hear about Elizabeth. They are fully fleshed humans. And the message of inclusivity plays out through Acts. God's message is for all. I'm going to ask Kylie to read part one, Luke 3, 15 to 17.
The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but the one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire."
Thanks, Kylie. The people were waiting expectantly. Expectantly. Isn't that a word for the year? Isn't John the Messiah? Isn't the world going to explode? And he is very quick to dissuade them. And before Christmas, and I think you can find this if you look up John Owen Wayside Live, John did a ripping sermon or talk on John the Baptist's message early in December. John the Baptist's message, to remind you, was his call was to repent and to be purified by baptism in running water, which was a Jewish custom, the mikvah. And this morning, I had a whole lot of stuff about Rome and the occupation and how everyone's expecting things to blow up. But I actually, this morning, woke up with the words from the book of Micah. The words of God, actually, that God asks us to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. Now, that has become the sweetest, most anodyne song, but in fact, it's actually a message of frustration from God to the people that Micah's talking to. This passage is so well misused, but John actually reflects that passage. People say, "What can we do?" And rulers should know justice. Leaders are motivated by self-interest. John attacks all these people. And Micah 5 is where, when Micah says, "Well, what do we do? Do we offer you rivers of oil, Lord? Do we offer you a firstborn child?" And Micah says the coming Messiah will do justice, love kindness, will walk humbly in God. Now, if I'm an oppressed Judean under the occupation of Rome, I don't know if I'm going to listen to that. Have I placed God at the center, as Graham has said? Because the expectations of the oppressed people of Rome were of desperate cries, and these words don't seem to mesh, and it just happens over and over and over again in the Old Testament. John employs hyperbole too here. "I am not fit to untie his sandals." I've always just gone, "Oh yeah, okay." But I did a bit of chat research this week. It was such a humiliating task to untie someone's sandals that not even a Jewish servant in a very rich household was required to do it. Now, I just want you to jump ahead in time. If John says that's humiliating, if it's so humiliating, how much more was Jesus' act of actually taking the sandals off and washing the followers' feet? Like, it's actually no wonder they were aghast. We just listen to that and go, "Oh, what a lovely act of humbleness." It's a huge act, but it breaks expectations again. As for the Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh is the Hebrew, Ruach HaKodesh, holy fire. Again, some people really hoped that this would literally burn away the Romans. When we get to the war of 66, 65, where Jerusalem is finally just smashed, because at the time of Jesus' birth, the empire set up a client kingdom under Herod in Judea, but the Qumran set really believed that if they attacked Rome, God would bring down holy fire. Expectations. Graham has been talking through Psalm 23 about the connection, the fire between us. He talks about this so often. And I'm going to move from here to almost to get Kylie to read part two. So we have John saying, I'm not the Messiah. People not necessarily listening because all John's message has been purely get ready, turn back, change your ways. Here Luke does something quite interesting. He actually theatrically moves John off the stage. I quite like Luke for the theatricality, although Mark is my favorite. But there are two verses, if you look back at 15 to 17, we miss out for some reason. Luke actually covers John the Baptist's arrest. And so in these passages off stage, we hear that John the Baptist was arrested and placed in jail under Herod. So he literally clears the stage of John's message and brings forward Jesus. And I'm going to ask Kylie to bring forward Jesus.
When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased."
When all the people, I don't think Jesus was the last numbered in the crowd. I don't know who baptized him. I know that Jesus, if we take him to be the Son of God, did not need to be baptized. Graham described it as a humiliation. So, you know, it's an act of utter humiliation for Jesus to stand in the water. And he prays, standing in the water, dripping wet, looking like another person in the crowd, nothing remarkable. And the skies open. So we're told a voice comes from above, claims Jesus for his son. We're told the physical form of the dove, I'm not going to go into, I'm not enough of a biblical scholar yet, but it's a very spare moment. It's as spare almost as Mark's version in 1:10. Expectations. No Messiah coming in on clouds of heaven. Jesus was always going to confound expectations. Jesus placed God at the center. Jesus was the words of Micah. He came and did justice. He loved kindness. He walked humbly with God. He was fiery. He was gentle. He was all those things with God at the center. In that moment, time bends again for me in an arc. Time bends in an arc, leading to two moments. The skies open, the temple curtain rips open at the moment of Jesus' death. We are all exposed now and can see God. And the resurrection, the restoration of God at the center. So God at the center, Graham said this to me when he was kindly listening to what I'd put together on Friday. And he said, I don't think we put God at the center enough. Oh, no, he didn't say that. He said, if you put God at the center. And he's riffed on that in Psalm 23, if you want to go back and listen. And it led me on a bit of a personal journey, which is a bit of Psalm 23, really. I don't think I place God at the center enough. And just like, this is not a self-serving comment. This is, I often place God on the sidelines. I actually went sports metaphor for some reason. I have never played soccer, but I kept thinking, you know, God is a coach, and I look over and God is a coach either shaking his head in shame, or God is a coach shaking her head in applause, or God is handing out oranges when I need them. You know, when I need them, that's me at the center. I'm about to embark on a year of prayer. I'll let you know if the God at the center changes. Expectations. So as to this moment in time, expectations, bearing under the weight of COVID and the 2022 goals that we might be setting, I'm actually going to bring up some words from one of my spiritual Bible teachers, a woman called Marcy Alvis Walker. She set this year as a year of hope. And Marcy lives in America, so I am so impressed that she can do this. She is worth looking up. If you look her up, I think Tim's put her name up on the screen. She's, I follow her Black Eyed Bible study. It's very worth subscribing. So, Marcy sent us a benediction of hope, keeping God at the centre, keeping the holy fire of love at the centre. And she invoked this, Majesty, we reach for you as you bend the heavens to reach us. She put up an image that I'm going to ask Tim if he can place up. And you should be seeing an image of a hand. And I'll show everyone here afterwards if they're interested. But out in the Atacama Desert in Chile, there is a sculpted hand rising out of the emptiness of the desert. La mano del desierto. If you look up La mano del desierto, you can read the name of the sculptor. My apologies to the sculptor. Now, monuments are tricky things. All you need to do is read a poem called Ozymandias, and you'll know a lot about the sarcasm behind monuments. But for Marcy, this hand, she says it feels like an attempt for a terrified and lonely generation to reach for the heavens, like a child begging to be held by an adult. Can you imagine driving along in the loneliness, like the nothingness, if you've ever been in the Australian desert, and seeing this, seeing that? It actually reminds me of the verse in Job when the morning stars sang in chorus and all the people of God shouted for joy, 38:7. That's really it for me. Thank you for listening. I'm going to finish with a couple of things from Marcy and one from me. May we learn, as Graham says, to keep the holy fire burning together. May we keep our eyes. I know the stars aren't where God lives, but it's the cosmos. And we keep our eyes above the horizon of our own. We look out past our own. May we shout for joy even when we cry the next minute. Marcy's words, from the tumultuous waves, we cry out to you. From the arid deserts, we cry out to you. Along the endless, desperate miles, we search for hope. Inside our desolation, you will meet us. Inside our despair, you will meet us. Our hope is in within you. And God says, this is all of you. You are loved. You are beloved. Thanks for listening. I think we're going to go out with something. Thank you so much for today. We'll see you next week.
Everybody. Thanks. Thank you.